Working with imported geometry can be frustrating. In 15 minutes, you'll have a solid foundation of best practices and tricks to help you turn imported CAD data into workable Fusion 360 assemblies. As a first step, it's critical to make sure that all parts are components. Fusion 360's components are required to create assembly models. Check out my lesson on bodies versus components if you're not already familiar. Some imported data may automatically place each body in a component. Some files will not. If not, you can quickly right-click on bodies in the browser, followed by Create Components from Bodies. We'll want to turn on Design History once all your parts are components. By default, imported models place you in direct modeling mode, which means the design history is not captured. We want to turn on the timeline so the joints are parametric should we need to update the assembly in the future. Right-click on the top level or root component and select Capture Design History. Turning on the timeline may take a few seconds to process if you have a lot of parts. Once complete, you'll see our timeline is visible. Before applying joints, you then need to decide on your assembly structure. The structure includes planning for how many sub-assemblies or individual components you need. There is truly no right or wrong answer here, as the assembly structure will depend on the need of your model. Using this Ender 3 example, you'll find that we already have 8 unique sub-assemblies in the browser. In Fusion 360, a sub-assembly represents any component that has nested components. In other words, a group of components that are related. The best way to think of sub-assemblies is to consider how you would assemble the product in real life. This is a great starting point for grouping components in your project. My goal is to make the X, Y, and Z axes realistic. Thus, the frame, LCD screen, spool holder, and other sub-assemblies don't require any motion. In such cases, creating an additional sub-assembly for all of those can help us utilize a rigid group. Let's create it first, and then we'll discuss the benefits of rigid groups. Let's create a new component named Base. Take note of the component icon. It's currently an individual component. Holding Command on Mac or Control on Windows will select all the components except each axis sub-assembly. We can then drag and drop them onto the base component, which results in a new sub-assembly. Notice how the icon changed to represent a sub-assembly. The main reason I wanted to create the additional sub-assembly was to speed up joining the parts together. In their current state, all components are simply floating in space. They'll freely move around if we drag them. Let's right-click on the base sub-assembly and select Isolate. Isolate will allow us to work on everything contained in the sub-assembly without seeing or affecting the other components. Again, our parts can move around if we were to click and drag on them. Let's also make sure the base sub-assembly is active. Activating the component is critical to ensure the joints become nested within the sub-assembly. Always take the time to consider this for your project. Keeping track of what component or sub-assembly is active is critical in the placement of joints. If we apply joints at the top level, we lose them when the individual sub-assembly is copied or inserted into another design file. To fully connect these components, one option would be to use Fusion 360's joint command to join each part together, one by one. For our use case, this would be a significant waste of time. This scenario is why Fusion 360 offers a unique command called Rigid Group. After activating it from the Assemble dropdown, we can select the subassembly or individual components in the browser. Note that we can automatically include all child components. This checkbox will include all nested components and subassemblies. After OK, you will see our rigid group is recorded in the timeline. All of our parts are now joined together. Notice how the parts can no longer move on an individual level. I also need to call out the Capture Position feature in the toolbar. Capture Position is also unique to Fusion 360 and something that confuses a lot of users. These icons present us with the option to capture the current position of the components or revert to the previous location. Capture Position will store the location of all components that have moved. Beware that this can lead to slow performance. The typical use case for this feature is position-dependent modeling. Let me know in the comments if you would like a lesson that goes into more detail on that subject. Generally speaking, you always want to revert the position if you don't have a purpose to capture it. Joints, align, move, and dragging components are all ways components can be moved, and each has unique use cases. We want to lock down this entire base subassembly for moving so we can focus on the rest of the subassemblies and joints. There are two main ways to do so. The first is to double-click on one of our parts in the model. Ideally, one that's the base of the part or one that touches the ground. We can then right-click on the highlighted component in the browser, allowing us to select the ground option. Notice the red thumbtack icon that now appears. The thumbtack represents a grounded component, which means it can no longer be dragged around or moved with joints. Because we have a rigid group holding all these components together, you will find that the entire subassembly can no longer move around. The main downside to the ground option is that we lose it if the assembly is ever inserted into another file. For this reason, many prefer the second method, which is to apply an as-built joint to the assembly's origin. Instead of using the unground option, consider deleting the ground command in your timeline. Deleting the command will keep your timeline clean by removing two unnecessary features, as unground will add a second command to your timeline. This time, I'll make sure the root component is active. This will ensure our entire assembly remains constrained to the origin should we ever insert the design into another file. Remember that every single individual component and subassembly has its origin. We can use as-built joints, which work with parts that are already in their desired location. We can select the center bar of the frame, followed by the root origin folder in the browser. After clicking OK, you'll find the assembly no longer moves. We're now ready to work on the remaining subassemblies. Let's start by isolating our Y subassembly as it touches our base frame. Starting the process over, decide what type of motion is required for the subassembly, as well as the motion that is not necessary. I'd like the build platform to move back and forth along the rail. I don't need the other parts to function, so it's not worth adding individual joints to the leveling knobs and other parts. We can start by isolating the bed subassembly. I want the rollers to revolve realistically, allowing them to slide along the Y rail. We can lock the remaining parts together with a rigid group. First, keep an eye on what's active in the browser. We want this rigid group to stay within the bed subassembly that it pertains to. Window selecting everything before activating the rigid group will allow us to quickly deselect the components that we don't want to be included. I'll deselect all four rollers as well as the 8 pillow components. After completion, we can drag the group away to make sure everything was included. Remember that rigid group is parametric, so you can always edit the feature and add or remove components as necessary. We now want to apply as-built joints in the order the parts touch each other. Thinking of it in this manner will help you apply the degrees of freedom to each component. Be sure to change the joint type to the revolute option before selecting the pillow and the pan head screw. We'll also need to place the joint origin at the center of the screw, which determines how this revolves. I'll repeat this process for the bottom pillow as well, ensuring they both revolve. Lastly, we need to add a rigid as-built joint to join the roller and the pillows. This joint will ensure the roller revolves with the pillows. In this case, we don't need to apply the joint to both of them. Instead, we can add a motion link to drive both revolute joints at the same time. Motion links allow you to specify the degrees of freedom between the selected joints. In this case, we'll leave them both to revolve 360 degrees at the same time. Note that when working with gears and other parts, you may need to flip the direction of one of them. You may have also noticed that the other roller subassembly inherited these joints while the other two did not. The one that inherited them is a copy of the subassembly the joints were applied to. Copies will automatically inherit any nested joints, making them efficient and easy to manage. This is one important consideration when working with imported data. Sometimes you'll find it best to delete some parts or sub-assemblies with the intent of copy and pasting them after you apply the appropriate joints. When done correctly, this can save significant time. To test the joint, right-click, drive joint, and move the rotation slider. Notice the roller component is moving along with it. I'll go ahead and apply the same joints to the other two sub-assemblies. Once complete, everything in our bed sub-assembly is joined together as desired. Remember to not capture position if you're simply moving the design around to test if joints were applied correctly. Always select revert and continue applying joints. We can now reactivate the Y-axis sub-assembly and isolate it, allowing us to finish the assembly. Currently, the rest of our Y-axis parts are not joined together. Again, how you approach this will depend on your desired outcome. If desired, we could take the time to make each stepper motor and pulley work together. However, there is currently no good way to move the belt realistically. With that in mind, I will apply a rigid group to this with the bed subassembly turned off. This rigid group lets us focus on the slider joint for the rail and rollers, followed by joining this subassembly to our frame. I recommend a window selection for the fastest path without having to select objects in the browser. With this bed visible again, we've got two core sub-assemblies. To make this bed slide, we want to first ask ourselves if the adjacent part is locked in place with the appropriate degrees of freedom. It currently moves, so let's join this to our base sub-assembly. We can turn the base back on and we'll want to make the root component active. We can now apply a rigid as-built joint to the two rails that touch. Always use the animation preview to ensure the joint is working as expected. Rigid will give you a shaking animation to visualize what's being joined together. We can reactivate our Y-axis sub-assembly as well as isolate it so we don't have to worry about anything else. Using the slider motion of an as-built joint, we can apply a joint to the roller and the main Y-axis. After selecting the roller and the main rail, I'll set the joint origin. This project is a great use case of the mode called Between Two Faces. Selecting a face on each side of the rail will help us snap the joint origin following the length of the rail. We can always opt to change the axis direction. Note that the preview will always show only one component moving. This is a performance thing and often confuses those who are new to Fusion 360 joints. All other relative joints will still be applied once you confirm the joint. In its current state, the roller will now slide along the rail. However, you'll find that it quickly twists because the other rollers still have more degrees of freedom. I'll repeat the slider joint on the other three rollers. Once complete, our bed will now slide along the rail as desired. Remember that you can right-click on joints to edit their joint limits. Joint limits allow you to set minimum and maximum boundaries that a part can travel from the joint origin. As desired, we could also apply any necessary motion links. For example, we could apply a motion link to the stepper motor and the slider joint if the stepper motor included a revolute joint. I'll use the unisolate all command from the root component, followed by activating the root component. We can now see the motion and joints in the context of the full assembly. To finish off the model, you'd want to work through the remaining two sub-assemblies following the same approach. Be sure to keep an eye on your Fusion 360 browser and which component or sub-assembly is active. Where you place your joints is critical in setting up successful assemblies and sub-assemblies that you can reuse as desired. Always apply joints to the part in your design, not the sub-assembly itself. One consideration is whether or not the rollers truly need to revolve. This, of course, depends on your project and needs. To be clear, for Fusion 360's sake, we could create rigid groups for all of the sub-assemblies and apply the slider joints to just the X, Y, and Z sub-assemblies. By defining their respective joint limits, this approach will have much better performance and take less time to complete. As you can see, this allows us to drag the extruder around within the limitations of the actual printer, simulating a realistic assembly. Let me know in the comments if you would like to see more videos like these, including advanced tutorials and related tricks. Special thanks to the new patrons and those who supported the channel via my Buy Me a Coffee page. If you've been learning with my tutorials, consider donating to help me continue on my mission to make CAD education accessible. Subscribe right here on YouTube for more free content. Then visit productdesignonline.com for more structured Fusion 360 courses and additional content. That's productdesignonline.com.